Please stand for the entry of the scriptures. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship at Midchurch, and I greet you all in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Okay, so this is how we're going to start. Like this. Come. Push your hands hard. Can you feel the heat? Go like this. Go. Oh, that feels better. Hey, does that feel better? Jeepers. My goodness, guys, what has happened? The first service was actually warmer this morning. Can you believe it? And we came out of worship in the first service, and it was this freezing weather. To all our online people who are either in other parts of the country or the world or maybe in your homes, we're very brave to come out this morning. It is freezing weather outside. So welcome, everyone. It is good to be in worship. And I'm going to encourage you to use your bodies in worship today. Get that blood moving and flowing. So as we do that, won't you turn to those around you, maybe like wave a hand or something to greet each other? Won't you greet each other warmly? Get that blood flowing. And welcome to all our online worshipers. It's lovely that you're able to participate in this way in worship this morning. We come to worship Jesus, who proclaims good news to the poor, who binds up the brokenhearted, who frees the prisoner, and who comforts those who mourn. We come to Jesus, who bestows a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of joy instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. We come to Jesus to worship, who rebuilds ancient ruins and restores broken places. We come to worship the resurrected Jesus, who will return. What a glorious day that will be. So friends, I invite you to join your voices together as we worship our God.
One day when heaven was filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. The Word became flesh and the light shined among us, his glory revealed, living he loved. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified, really forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. One day they led him up Calvary's mountain. One day they nailed him to die on a tree. Suffering, anguish, despised and rejected. Bearing our sins, my Redeemer is he. The hand that healed nations stretched out on a tree and took the nails for me, living.
Ascended, my Lord, evermore.
Death could
what do we have that you have not given us? Our hearts should be overwhelmed with thanksgiving every day for the blessings that flow from your grace. Your mercy on us has been great and completely undeserved. There is no one like our God. Lord, you are infinite, you're omnipotent, omniscient, you're ever true. You spoke all of creation into existence, and yet you dressed the flowers in beauty. You brought all of humanity to life, and yet you saw each of us in our mother's wombs. In all of heaven and earth, there is none like you, and no one can love us as you do. And we pray, Lord, for this truth to settle deep into our hearts and our minds, bringing from us the call of praise. O Lord, who is like you? Forgive us for making little of you, Lord, for honoring you only when it suits us, for making the problems of this world more and the power of your presence less, for allowing our vision to be diminished, losing sight of the glory and the beauty of this life. In your great mercy, O Lord, restore our hearts, restore our sight, restore our lives. Come, Holy Spirit, anoint us afresh. Surprise us, move us, overwhelm us in your love. In Jesus' name, amen. We are no longer slaves to fear.
No longer a slave to fear.
Friends, today we come to the Lord's table to share in this holy feast together as a family of faith in Him. And as we do so, we prepare our hearts by singing, "Behold the Lamb." Amen. Please have a seat, and if the elders would come forward. Friends, this table belongs to the Lord Jesus, and He is the one who invites all who wish to receive from Him to come, and to come gladly, to come expectantly. We are not the hosts, He is. The invitation is extended to all to come
and receive. And just as the Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, took some bread and took some wine, so I take these elements, as well as those whom at home are preparing to share communion, what you have with you set apart from all common and ordinary and everyday use, for this holy use and mystery. Before they shared in the meal, they said thank you, they gave thanks. And so we will do the same. Come, let's pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, this morning we affirm that yours are the white beaches, the green fields, the brown and dusty plains, the clouds in the sky, the rain and the sunshine, all yours. And yours are the hearts that falter, the mourner who grieves, the living and the dying. Yours are the joys that we experience and the laughter that fills our hearts. And though we are of dust and our days are like the grass of the field, yet you do not take your hand from us, for you have made us all. And you have assured us that you will be with us forever. And so we give you thanks. Lord, you have called us from near and far, each different in face and in heart, but all of us your people. You lead us through the desert and the darkness to a city of light. You go before us while we live. You are with us on the day we die. And Heavenly Father, you are most blessed because of Jesus of Nazareth, your Son, our Christ. He came and he worked your will in the world. Before he suffered and died for us, he took bread and wine in his hands and he gave them to his friends. And therefore, Lord God, with this bread and this cup, we proclaim his death for the sins of the world. And we commemorate his resurrection until he comes in glory one day. Please would you send your Holy Spirit on us, that as we eat and drink this bread and this wine, that Jesus may be with us and in us. Make us new people, people who hear your voice and obey you with all our hearts. Lord, make us worthy that with joy and without any presumption, we may be so bold as to call upon you, our God in heaven, as we sing the prayer that Jesus taught us. So hear the words of the institution as they are brought to us by Paul. He writes to the Christians in Corinth. He says, what I've received from the Lord, I can now pass on to you, that Jesus, on the night of his betrayal and his arrest, took some bread from the table. He broke it And he said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Eat of it, all of you." And after they had eaten, he took a cup from the table. He said, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, that whenever you drink it, you do so in remembrance of me." And so whenever we eat this bread and drink of this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. The body of Christ given for me. Eddie, the body of Christ given for you. Derek, the body of Christ given for you. This is the blood of Jesus shed for the forgiveness of my sins. Eddie, the blood of Jesus for you. Derek, blood of Jesus for you. So friends, these are God's gifts for his people. So taste and see that indeed the Lord is good to us. His body given, his blood shed. Eat and drink in remembrance of him.
Thank you.
And let's stand, and we're going to pray together. Lord God, may we who have shared in Christ's body this morning around this table live in the power of his risen life within us. We who have drunk his cup, may we share his life with others. We whom the Spirit enlightens, take your light out into the world. And we pray that you will keep us firm in the hope that you have set before us, until we and all your children are free and the whole earth praises your name. Amen. May the peace of Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Amen. Please would you pass the peace to those who are around you. Please have a seat. Very special welcome this morning to any visitors amongst us. Anyone here for the first time? Would you be brave enough to raise your hand? Welcome. Over there, welcome. Peter, where are you, sir? Peter's got the big black jacket over here, and he wants to welcome the two of you there. That's lovely, with a little gift. And Peter will be at our notice board after worship, right in front of you, Pete. He will be glad to chat with you and tell you more about who we are. Friends, I remind you that we are all missionaries. We are witnesses to Christ in whatever circumstances we find ourselves in. You don't have to go, you know, to a foreign land to be able to be a missionary, right where you are, in your home, in your business, in your neighborhood, amongst friends, amongst family. You and I are called to give testimony to Christ. So I encourage you to do that, to invite others to know Jesus, perhaps through this congregation and our ministry here, but certainly to have that opportunity. This morning, the Gaza family are leading us in our tithes and offerings. So if you'd please come forward and help us with that, that would be marvelous. I remind you that our tithes and offerings are given with thankful hearts and caring hands. And the offertory bags will be passed around, and of course for EFTs, the bank details are on our website. It's awesome. Thanks.
Good morning, church.
Morning.
Our scripture reading is 1 John, second chapter, from verses 15 to 17. I will ask Nontlanhla to read for us.
Don't love the Lord's ways. Oh, sorry about that. Don't love the world's ways. Don't love the world's goods. Love of the world squeezes out love for the Father. Practically everything that goes on in the world, wanting your own way, wanting everything for yourself, wanting to appear important, has nothing to do with the Father. It just isolates you from him. The world and all its wanting is on the way out. But whoever does what God wants is set for eternity.
Thank you. Can I ask June and Andile to help us with the offerings?
Thank you.
Thank you very much, church. Can I ask Tobega to pray for us?
Let us pray. Father, we give our tithes and offerings to you. Thank you to everybody who has given today in person and also via EFT payments. Bless and use these to accomplish your will through this church. We ask that every amount will be invested in the furthering of your work. Grant wisdom to those who will handle the appropriation of these funds so that we may make good, productive, and wise uses of the tithes and offering we are giving you today. Direct our ministry towards spending and spreading the gospel and discipline your children towards spiritual growth and service, and bless the works of our hands. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, guys, for assisting us in that way. That's wonderful. And we have a couple of ministry minutes this morning. Rachel is the first one. So she's going to tell us about our long-anticipated teen camp.
Good morning, everybody. It is indeed T-minus 2 months until we set off with our teenagers on our teen camp. It's been about 4 years since the teens of our community have gathered together for a youth camp, and it was hosted here at Ministry House. And it's been 7 years since we have taken our teens away for a teen camp. So to say we are beyond excitement is an understatement. In a world filled with information and influence, our prayer is that the teenagers amongst us will solidify their faith and trust in our Lord Jesus over this weekend. And so to the dearest teens of Midchurch and our community, it is time to get your sign-ups in. So if you are in grade 7 to grade 12, on the 22nd of September, we will be departing all together on a bus to Rocky Valley, the campsite in Krugersdorp, to have a weekend together of fun with our friends while growing our faith. We will then return on the Sunday afternoon, the 24th of September. It will cost 500 Rand per teen for the weekend, which includes accommodation, which isn't in a tent, so don't worry, and delicious food. So teens, get yourself and your friends signed up. The QR code is outside on the board, and we will also be sharing the link with you in the coming week. The leaders of the teen camp have worked to make the camp as affordable as possible for the teens in our community. Hence, it is only 500 Rand for the weekend. However, that is only half the cost. So, to you, the congregation, we ask if you are keen and able to sponsor the other half and allow a teen to attend the camp, that would be wonderful. You can make your sponsorship into the Midchurch bank account with the reference teen camp. Your support will be much, much appreciated and will go a long way in allowing a teen to deepen their faith in our Lord and to make friends and fellowship with like-minded teenagers. So your donation and sponsorship really would be appreciated. Thank you.
Awesome. Thanks, Rachel.
It's a mom and daughter act today. I need glasses. I'm much older. I want to share with you something of the baby church. So I'm going to read it because I really want to get this right and clear. Towards the end of last year, the young people at Midchurch work group realized that our baby room was quickly becoming too small. In the wake of the pandemic, we had an amazing increase in the number of babies at Midchurch. I don't know what everyone got up to then. While it was awesome to welcome so many babies each week, baby church was not as much fun anymore because we were all squashed into a very tiny space. Thankfully, it was summer, so we could go outside and hold our lessons on the lawn. But this was not a long-term solution. The work group then set about putting together a proposal to present to the session, detailing our plans for a new baby room. that would be spacious, vibrant, and a comfortable place for our babies to meet. The cost of the new baby room came to a staggering 75,000 rand. This had not been budgeted for in the Midchurch finances. But recognizing the importance of this ministry, the session approved the purchase and furnishing of the baby room, but suggested we make an appeal for donations from the Midchurch family to help cover the cost. Given the tough times we are all experiencing at the moment, the work group was concerned about that amount and how much we would receive through donations. But nonetheless, we put out the request. And to date, 73,000 of the 75,000 cost has been donated by you, the Midchurch family. Both the work group and the session are bowled over by your generosity and so thankful for every donation. At our work group meeting last Tuesday, we were reminded again that it is the Lord who plans and directs ministry. And when we are in line with His will, the seemingly impossible can be achieved. Our beautiful new baby room is now 99% complete, and today we will officially open it for ministry to our youngest Midchurch members. Please join the work group and the baby church team after this service at the baby room, if you don't know, it's just down from the tea lawns, for a ribbon cutting and a prayer outside so that we can officially open this space to our babies. So God bless you all, and with much love from the work group and the baby church team.
Wonderful. Thanks so much, Karen. All right, youngsters, it's time to head out. Babies to the baby church and the kids down to the hall and tweens and teens to ministry house. Thanks so much. And adults, we of course stay here for our group work. He came singing love, the choir are ministering to us today. Thank you so much. So we have special visitors back today. Pam and Erin, hello. It's been over a year that you moved to the UK, and it's great that you guys are visiting with us. And I think you greeted most people already, but it's lovely to see you both. And the Lowe's have blessed us with the beautiful flowers today, just in Thanksgiving for the last year or so in their move and settling in. Donated by the Lowe family in gratitude for last year's journey to the UK, for opening doors and walking alongside us. That's lovely. Thanks, guys. It's really beautiful and wonderful to see you again. Friends, the prayer cross is outside. Please make use of it, bringing your prayer requests to our prayer teams. They are ready and waiting to intercede on your behalf for your needs. If you aren't here, of course, if you're online, please use the email address prayer@midchurch.com. So that those requests can get to our teams. This coming Saturday is the monthly weeding planting day in the farm, and we have got an incredible winter crop. The team have done a wonderful job along with all the volunteers through these winter months that we actually have got the right stuff growing in the winter months, and it's looking good, but we need those crops attended to, so maybe you want to consider giving an hour or so next Saturday morning. Come and enjoy that time. You've heard we're hosting the Alpha Course. We're very excited. The Alpha Course, it has for years around the world been used as a very effective tool to reach unchurched people, even de-churched people. Now, those folk who used to worship and then left the faith for some reason, and also just to assist Christians who've been part of the faith for many years, but still have some questions and want to renew their faith in the Lord. And it's a 2.5-month course, runs on Wednesday evenings down at Ministry House. If you've never attended before, I want to invite you to do that. And I also want to ask you to invite a family member or a friend to come. You have to be intentional in doing that. You've got to go to them and say, here's information about a course I think you will benefit from. So please go ahead and do that. The sign-ups are all outside. There's a QR code for the Google form and also a physical sign-up. You can use that. And then also to encourage you that maybe you're wanting to sponsor someone to attend the course, because we don't want to charge anyone for this course. So we're looking for sponsorships. So if you're able to do that, please do. The details are there about how to sponsor, and so that we can get as many people as possible on the course. And allow them to go through this journey of faith. And not only with themselves, but with others. And to discover one of the wonderful blessings of being a Christian is that you have this automatic family who are around you and become a blessing for you, and you become a blessing for them. So please do remember that. And then also I wanted to share with you just a reminder that on Fridays, on the church WhatsApp groups, I send through to you a little link to our newsletter called The Link. And on there, are often photographs and feedback from ministries that you don't always hear about on a Sunday. And also, obviously, adverts about upcoming things, etc. So just to encourage you to click on that and to have a look so that you can keep up to speed with what's happening in the life of our community. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. So come. Let's stand and worship the Lord.
Thank you.
God, it is a joy once again to be able to gather at your feet, as it were, to receive gladly your word to us, written in Scripture, revealed through Scripture and through proclamation. And we pray that as you bring your word to us today, that our hearts would be ready and glad to receive, to be equipped, empowered, commissioned by your word to go and live boldly and courageously in the world according to your purposes and for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Please have a seat. So, for hundreds and thousands of years, human beings have been trying to make sense of death. The ancient Egyptians built pyramids as tombs for their kings. They wrote the Book of the Dead to guide the dead in the next life. The Babylonians, they buried household goods with their loved ones to be used in the next life, as did many other cultures before and since. The Greeks talked about some vague existence after death beyond the river Styx. African traditional religion calls for the living to appease the ancestors and seek their guidance. Hebrew prophets and psalmists hinted of a shadow life in the underworld that is called Sheol, the place of the dead. As we all know too well, death is real. But what about afterwards? Because if there is life after death, that changes everything. On Friday, I started the memorial service for Reg Voss, a long-standing member of the Reinkiesfontein community. We had a memorial service here for him, and I started that service, as I do all memorial and funeral services, with these words: "Welcome to a worship service in which we bear witness to the resurrection and give thanks to God for the life of, you know, whomever." In which we bear witness to the resurrection. So today we come to the end of our teaching series that I have thoroughly enjoyed preaching and has been for myself quite a blessing. I believe a journey in faith and belief with the Apostles' Creed. And I want to remind you for the final time of how important it is to have an understanding of what we believe about God, about ourselves, about others, about the big wide world out there, what we believe about work, what we believe about play, what we believe about relationships, about everything. Because our belief determines our thinking and our ideas, which then shapes our feelings, which then prompts our actions and our doing in the world. What we choose to believe, because belief is a choice about anything and everything. We are born as a blank slate into this world. We choose to believe things that shape our thinking and our feeling and our doing in the world. So what we choose to believe forms our view of the world. It is our world view, which then shapes our identity and our understanding of our purpose and how we must relate to others and to God. And so we have spent 8 weeks already. Can you believe it? Time just flies. We've spent 8 weeks considering the beliefs summarized in the Apostles' Creed. And remember, creed comes from the Latin credo, which means I believe. It's just the first two words of this statement of faith. So before we get to the final two lines of the Apostles' Creed, I thought it would be good for us to affirm our faith through the words of the Apostles' Creed. So I'd like to invite those of you who want to do that and who are able to stand to please join me so that we can recite the Creed together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please have a seat. So the final two lines of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in the resurrection of the body and the life everlasting. 1 Corinthians 15, verses 1 to 8. Paul writing to the Christians in Corinth, and he says, now, brothers and sisters, I want to remind you of the gospel that I preached to you, which you received and on which you take your stand. I believe, on which you take your stand. By this gospel, you are saved. If you hold firmly to the word I preached to you, otherwise, you have believed in vain for no reason. For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. We spoke about this last week. Eh? I believe in the forgiveness of sins. That he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, that's Simon Peter, to Peter, and then to the 12. After that, he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers and sisters at the same time, most of whom are still living, though some have fallen asleep, died. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles, and last of all, he appeared to me also. You'll remember Paul on the road to Damascus, that experience of seeing Jesus. Approximately 1,985 years ago, Jesus Christ rose from the dead. His resurrection had such an impact on the disciples that they were transformed from men who were afraid for their lives. They were hiding. Remember, they were afraid that what had happened to Jesus, whom they were following, would happen to them as well. So they're hiding. But they're transformed from those men of fear to boldly telling others in Jerusalem that Jesus was alive, that there was life after his death, and that he was the long-awaited Messiah. They were filled with courage from the Holy Spirit, and they feared no one. In Acts 4, verse 33, we are told about this, that with great power, the apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And in Acts 17, verse 18, Paul is now visiting Athens in Greece, and he's having a debate with all the philosophers of the city. And we get this comment. A group of Epicurean and Stoic philosophers began to debate with Paul. Some of them asked, what is this babbler trying to say? Others remarked, he seems to be advocating foreign gods. They said this because Paul was preaching the good news about Jesus and the resurrection. The good news about Jesus Christ and the resurrection. Jesus rose from the dead, and the apostles continued to testify, to bear witness to his life after his death. And notice what Jesus said of himself and resurrection, even before he had actually died and then risen from the dead. You'll know this story well. A good friend of his, Lazarus, dies, and word is brought to Jesus about Lazarus' death. So he travels and he goes to meet with Mary and Martha, Lazarus's sisters, and all the other family and friends who have gathered to mourn and grieve Lazarus's death. Jesus is about to raise him back to life, and he has a conversation with Lazarus's sister Martha in John 11, 23 to 26. Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." And Martha answered, "I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die." And he asks her, "Do you believe this?" Martha, do you believe in life after death? And do you believe that I have power over death? There is absolutely no doubt in the mind of Jesus that there is life after physical death. No doubt. One of the clearest statements from Jesus in this regard is when he says in John 14, "My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me that you may be where I am. I believe in the resurrection of the body and the life everlasting. Do you believe this? Because if you do, it changes everything. It changes how we think about death. It will change how we feel about death. And it will change how we act in this life." A few years ago, when I was going over the Apostles' Creed with one of our confirmation groups, one of the confirmees asked about this last line, "I believe in the resurrection of the body and life everlasting." She said to me, "Is this just metaphorical language?" I said, "No. When we die, we do not turn into some or other ethereal spirit that kind of leaves this earthly body and then goes around all over the place, you know, floating for eternity. We believe quite strongly, based on Jesus' own bodily resurrection, that we will have physical bodies after we die, though a little different than they are now." A few weeks ago, Rachel shared a meme with me that she found on Instagram. It read like this: "Brain cells die, skin cells die, even hair cells die, but fat cells must have accepted Jesus as their Lord and Savior because they have eternal life." Ain't that the truth? Why don't fat cells die? Everything else dies. They stay there forever. I think that most of us have a bit of a love-hate relationship with our bodies and would be quite happy to be free of them when we die. We certainly take care of our bodies. We feed them, we wash them, we even pamper them. We spend a large amount of time cooking special meals we like to eat that satisfies our palates. We spend lots of money on clothes to wear, maybe hours in the gym or on the bike or running on the road to get in shape. Think about all the time that you spend every day on your beautiful body. And yet we get annoyed and frustrated at our bodies for the way in which they limit us. And when you get right down to it, there are many things about our bodies that some of us may not like. We may feel that we're too short or we're too tall. We may think our nose is too long or our smile is crooked. We may complain about the corns and the calluses on our feet. We grow dissatisfied. And unfortunately, some of us even feel ugly, which is a great sadness, I think. And then we have other occasions in our life when our bodies let us down and they begin to deteriorate. We experience a sense of loss over that, as our bodies no longer are able to do the things that they once did. And Jesus sums this up so well in Matthew. He says, the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. I remember her name just popped to mind. Elsie Wegner. Elsie Wegner was an elderly lady in my first congregation in PE. And she lived into her 90s. I still love visiting Elsie. Just bright smile and just full of life. And I think it was when she turned about 80 or 85. She said to me, you know, Christopher, I feel like I'm 16 years old. My body's the problem. Goodness. And so in Psalm 139, we are affirmed that it is affirmed that we are fearfully and wonderfully made. When God created the heavens and the earth and he created you and me, he declared that it was good. Your body is good. Of course, we understand that our bodies and all of creation has been affected by sin, with the consequent brokenness of creation, which we all experience, and which will lead to the eventual death of our bodies. This is the reality we all must face. But the good news is that Jesus has defeated that old enemy, death, and we will be resurrected in body. Death does not have the final word. Jesus declares that he is the resurrection, and in him we see a foretaste of what will happen to us when we die. And so in Philippians 3:21 we are told, Jesus Christ will transform our lowly bodies so that they will be like his glorious body. And in 1 Thessalonians 4, Paul writes, we believe, there it is again, hey? We believe that Jesus died and rose again. And so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him, those who have died. According to the Lord's word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will not precede those who have fallen asleep, those who have died before us. For the Lord himself will come from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Will rise first. So, just as Jesus rose from the dead, so will we. I believe in the resurrection of the body. Death is conquered. We will rise. In what form? Just like Jesus, when he appeared to all those people, a resurrected body. I believe in the resurrection of the body and in the life everlasting, eternal life. What is that all about? We are never told in the Bible what eternal life is like. Interestingly, Jesus says this about eternal life in John 17. I mean, he says that as plainly as this. Now, this is eternal life. Okay, so now you want to prick up your ears and pay attention. This is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. So, eternal life is knowing God, which means that it has already started. Not just one day when we die, physically, but now already. Eternal life has started for us. Death is simply a transition from one form to another. Paul then weighs in on this in 1 Corinthians 15. We're not going to read this passage. It's a long chapter, but I encourage you to go and read it if you're interested. 1 Corinthians 15, he addresses this whole issue of our resurrected bodies, and he says that just like Jesus after his resurrection, we too will have resurrected bodies after we die. And then he tries to explain both the continuity and the discontinuity of our bodies in this life and the next life. And the language that he uses to express this is natural bodies versus spiritual bodies. Earthly bodies versus heavenly bodies. Perishable bodies versus imperishable bodies. Not all flesh is the same, he says. In other words, we will have bodies, but a little different. In John 20, we get a sense of this. Jesus rises from the dead, and he's in the garden and Mary sees him. He appears to Mary, but she doesn't recognize him at first. So he's a little different than before. But then he says her name, and she realizes who it is. Later in the day, he appears to other believers, and he shows them the holes in his hands and his feet and his side, which means that it is his body. It is him. But it's a little bit different. Same, but different. Then in Mark 12, Jesus answers a question from the Sadducees about eternal life. They want to know about our relationships in heaven. It's a good question. They were trying to be a bit cheeky and snotty, but it's a good question. And they want to know, you know, do our relationships continue? So they put a scenario to Jesus where they say there's a woman who has had seven husbands, because all her husbands have died one after the other. I would have thought by like number four, the guy's thinking, sure, I must be careful. But seven husbands. So they say to Jesus, who is she married to in eternal life in heaven? And Jesus' response is to say, when the dead rise, so he's quite clear about that, when the dead rise, life after death, they will neither marry nor be given in marriage. They will be like the angels in heaven. What does that mean? Well, it seems that eternal life is different to this life. We are ourselves, that is affirmed, but our relationships from this life seem to be a little bit different in eternal life. Then in terms of analogies, eternal life is also spoken of as a house. In John 14, which we read earlier, Jesus assures us, in my Father's house, other translations have in my Father's mansion, whatever, there are many rooms. I'm going there to prepare a place for you, and I'll come back to take you to be with me. Other evocative language used in the Bible speaks of eternal life like a wedding banquet in Revelation 19 and a feast in Matthew 8. So maybe there's good food, in eternal life. But will it be pap and vleis, or curry and rice, or burgers and chips, or veal cordon bleu? We just don't know. And then in Revelation 21, verse 4, we are told that it'll be a place without any pain or suffering. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, we are told. There will be no more death, no more mourning, no more crying, no more pain, for the old order of things has passed away. There's a new order. Whatever everlasting life may or may not be like, what I am convinced of is that when we died, we do not die into nothingness. We die into God. And for me, that is enough. Paul affirms in Romans 14, we do not live to ourselves, we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord. If we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. In Revelation 14, John hears a voice in his vision from God's presence saying, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord from now on. Why are the dead blessed? Blessed are the dead. We are blessed because we will be with God, and we will be resurrected, and we will have everlasting life. Martin Luther claimed that life after death is God's business, so he did not want to worry too much about it, and I feel much the same. He also pointed out that we can know as little about the afterlife. This is a very helpful illustration. We can know as little about the afterlife as a baby can, who is passing through the birth canal, about the world the baby is about to be born into. Very helpful illustration. That baby has no cooking clue. And in fact, think this is going to be a disaster. This is painful. There's lights. What is going on? I just want to stay here. This is so much more comfortable, so much better. I'm fed. It's cool. And has no idea what lies beyond, but it's better. You know? And so Luther makes that same point about we have no idea what our everlasting life is like. You know, but it'll be better. And it'll be with the Lord. That is all we need to know. As interesting as the debate about everlasting life may be, what is really important is that we die into God. And that is enough. The resurrection of the body and the life everlasting changes everything. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all my fear is gone. It changes everything. So how can we not, like those first disciples, go and tell others about the resurrection of Jesus? So won't you go and live fully to the glory of God and tell others of the resurrection. Amen. Come, let's pray. God of grace, you have given us a new and living hope in Jesus Christ. And we thank you that by dying and rising from the dead, Jesus destroyed the power of death and he opened the way to eternal life. And help us, we pray, to know that because he lives, we also will live. And that neither death, nor life, nor things present, nor things to come are able to separate us from his love. We thank you that because of your love for us, Lord, we are able to see beyond the grave. We are able to rejoice in the life which you offer to each and every one of us. We praise you for your Holy Spirit who continues to work salvation in our lives today, that in opening our hearts to your presence and your resurrection Spirit, you invite us to join with you in the great adventure of grace and love that is taking place in the world at this very moment all around us. Lord God, as we choose to believe, as we place our trust in you, move us in heart and mind to work with you in these times of great trial, to bring your love, to bring the truth of the gospel and the resurrection to the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So friends, go and live your life according to what you believe. Go and understand that you already live the victorious life that God has given you. And go and tell others about it. If you've come here this morning and have a ministry burden, please won't you stay for worship and for ministry. Our elders will pray with you. Please go to the notice board and that and the ministry table and go and sign up. Maybe you want to sign up for Alpha. You want to sign someone else up for Alpha. Maybe you want to sponsor someone. Maybe it's you want to sign up a teenager for the camp. Maybe you want to sponsor a teenager for the camp. Please go and do all those things. And I couldn't see with the door opening if the wind has died down. I hope it has. The sun is out at least. So go and have some biscuits and coffee and fellowship after worship. And meal packs are on sale, so you can distribute as you see need. Can we conclude? Thine be the glory, risen, conquering Son. Let's stand. Won't you receive the blessing in the words of Romans 15? May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit you may abound in hope.